The Constitution of India, Preamble. We, the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic and to secure to all its citizens justice, social, economic and political, liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship, equality of status and of opportunity, and to promote among them all fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nation. In our Constituent Assembly, this 26th day of November 1949, do hereby adopt, enact and give to ourselves this Constitution.
Happy morning, students. So, I hope you are comfortable with the new chapter, Chemical Bonding. Almost we have come to the end of the chapter. Now, this time I'll be posting the videos because last time the length was little bit big. So, I couldn't insert any new videos into that. So, I'll be inserting the videos now in this so that you can understand what is VSC PR theory, valence bond theory and hybridization also. So, today's chapter we are going to start with stability of molecules, that is in molecular orbital theory. Now, I told you in molecular orbital theory there are two types of bonding taking place. One is bonding where the stability will be different, the energy required will be different, and you have antibonding, again the energy difference will be, there is a slight variation in the energy difference of the molecules. Now, how to find out whether my given molecule is stable or not? To find the stability of the molecule or to find out the magnetic nature, we use this molecular orbital theory. So, this theory helps us to find out the stability of the molecule and also the magnetic character. Now, when I include about the stability, NB and NA are the two new terms which we are learning. NB refers to bonding electrons, which means electrons which are present in the bonding orbitals. NA refers to electrons which are present in the antibonding orbitals. So, these are NA and NB. So, if NB is greater than NA, that is the electrons present in the bonding orbitals are more than the electron presence in the antibonding orbital, then my given molecule is stable. I hope you are able to follow. The bonding electrons are more than the antibonding electrons, then the given molecule will be stable. If it is less than the antibonding orbitals, then the given molecule is unstable. So, when you are filling the molecular orbitals only, you can find out whether the given molecule is stable or not. Then we have few terms which will help us to find out about the information with the given molecule. First one is bond order. What is bond order? It is half of the NB, that is electrons in the bonding orbital minus electrons in the antibonding orbitals. That is NB minus NA by 2, or I can write half of NB minus NA. So, that gives the bond order. If you have a positive bond order, the given molecule is highly stable. If you have negative, or it can be even zero bond order, the given molecule will be unstable. Once we find the bond order, we should find out the nature of bond, whether the given molecule has got a single bond or it is made up of two bond or it is a triple bonded molecule. With that, if the bond order comes to be 1, 2, 3, we'll find out whether how many bonds are present between those two atoms in that molecule. Then comes the bond length. It is the bond order between the two atoms. So, there are two atoms, like for example N2 or H2, when I take, the bond order between the two atoms gives the bond length, and the bond length decreases, the bond order increases because it is inversely proportional. Then comes the last point, which is the magnetic nature. See, when we are filling the electrons in the orbital, we know we use the Hund's rule. That is, when you are using that rule, it should be first singly occupied, then only the pairing takes place. So, when you have the molecular orbitals which are doubly occupied, which consist of two electrons, all the orbitals completely filled, then the given molecule is diamagnetic in nature. On the other hand, if you find the electrons singly occupied, they become paramagnetic in nature. So that is how we do the magnetic character of the given molecule. So with this, we will now learn how the molecular orbital diagram can be drawn and how can we find out the bond order. How to draw the molecular orbital diagram and how to calculate the bond order and to find out whether the given molecule is stable or whether it exists or not. Now let's first see the example H2, where hydrogen's atomic number is 1. So according to electronic configuration, it is 1s1. So I have two hydrogen atoms, 1s1 on either side. So according to Hund's rule, again I am saying first the bonding will be filled, then comes the antibonding. So here in 1s1, the first electron comes and fills here. The second electron will not go to antibonding, but it will occupy the bonding orbital. So I have two electrons in the bonding orbital and no electron available in the antibonding orbital. So how do I find the bond order? Bond order will be Nb minus Na by 2. This is the formula. So here I have two electrons in the bonding, minus 0 by 2, which is 2 by 2, that is 1, which means the nature of bond is single between the two hydrogen atoms and it is a stable molecule. It is a positive bond order. So this is how we do it for hydrogen atom. Now let us do it for helium molecule, that is two helium atoms. Atomic number is 2, so it will be 1s2. On either side I have written helium 1s2 and helium 1s2. According to the Hund's rule, first these two electrons will occupy the bonding orbital, so that becomes sigma 1s2, right? And then here it is sigma star, which is antibonding. I have two more electrons in the other helium, which will be occupying the antibonding molecular orbital. Now how to find out the bond order? It will be Nb minus Na by 2, which will be bonding. I have two electrons here, 2 minus this 2 will be 0, 0 by 2 will be again 0, which shows that helium molecule do not exist. So likewise, they have given for lithium, carbon, oxygen, right? So we will be, I'll be sending the video also for all these molecules, which will be helping you to understand much better. Then comes the hydrogen bonding. What do you mean by hydrogen bonding? The bonding of hydrogen atom with any other atom, right, within the molecule, or it can be outside the molecule with another molecule, is called as hydrogen bonding. So let's learn quickly about hydrogen bonding. As I told you, this is hydrogen bonding. Attractive force that binds the hydrogen atom of one molecule with an electronegative atom of another molecule. So the hydrogen atom in one molecule, if it is bonded to an electronegative atom, what exactly happens? Electronegative atom start attracting the electron pair towards itself. So here the hydrogen having electrons will be moving far away from the hydrogen and reaches fluorine, and that's how fluorine acquires a fractional negative charge, or I can say a partial negative charge, and this acquires a partial positive charge. So it becomes delta plus and delta minus. So now this fluorine again has an hydrogen bonding with another hydrogen fluoride. So this bonding continues. Such type of bonding we call it as intermolecular hydrogen bonding, where hydrogen bonds with electronegative atoms of another molecule. One hydrogen binds with another electronegative atom of another molecule. So there is something which is called as intramolecular. There is a difference. Inter is with one molecule and another molecule. Intra means within the same molecule, where hydrogen is present between two electronegative atoms. It can be oxygen, fluorine. So what happens here? I have this OH, this is ortho nitrophenol. Here in ortho group, I have this nitro position. Ortho position you will not learn now, we will learn in the organic part. I have an NO2 group here, an OH group here. There is a bond between the oxygen and the hydrogen of two different groups within the molecule. Such type of bonding we call it as intramolecular hydrogen bonding. So with this, the hydrogen bonding is also getting over. I'll try to put the videos, already it is ready. I'll send it along with this video so that you will have an exact idea of what is chemical bonding is all about with different examples. So with this, the fourth chapter is over. We will be beginning the fifth chapter in the next class. Make sure that you are on with the syllabus. You have your exams also right now. So don't make too much lagging of the videos. Also make sure that you spend time to continue with the videos that have been posted in the same week. Okay. With this, we'll wind up the class for today. Thank you, children. Take care. Have a great day. Bye.
Valence shell electron pair repulsion theory. The valence shell electron pair repulsion, or the VSEPR theory, is used to predict the geometry of different molecules. It is also referred to as the Gillespie-Nyholm theory, after its two main developers, Ronald Gillespie and Sir Ronald Nyholm. The VSEPR theory states that the shape of a molecule depends on the number of valence shell electron pairs around the central atom. Electron pairs could be bond pairs or lone pairs. Electron pairs in the valence shell tend to repel one another as their electron clouds are negatively charged. The electron pairs try to occupy positions such that the repulsions are minimized. Since a lone pair is closer to the central atom than the bond pairs, lone pair repulsion is stronger than lone pair bond pair repulsion, which in turn is stronger than the bond pair repulsion. Hence, the number of electron pairs determines the overall geometry of a molecule. Geometries of molecules can be classified on the basis of VSEPR theory as those with bond electron pairs and those with bonded and lone pairs both. Click each tab to learn about them. Geometries of molecules with bonded electron pairs are of different types. In type AB2, the molecule acquires a linear geometry if there are two bond pairs around the central atom. Beryllium dichloride is an example of a molecule with linear geometry. A molecule with three bond pairs around the central atom acquires a trigonal planar geometry. Boron trifluoride is an example of a molecule with trigonal planar geometry. In type AB4, the molecule with four bond pairs around the central atom acquires a tetrahedral geometry. Methane is an example of a molecule with tetrahedral geometry. In type AB5, the molecule with five bond pairs around the central atom acquires a trigonal bipyramidal geometry. Phosphorus pentachloride is an example of a molecule with trigonal bipyramidal geometry. In type AB6, the molecule with six electron pairs around the central atom acquires an octahedral geometry. Sulfur hexafluoride is an example of a molecule with octahedral geometry. Geometries of molecules containing bonded as well as lone pairs are of different types. In type AB2L, the molecule with two bond pairs and one lone pair acquires a bent or an angular shape. A molecule of sulfur dioxide shows a bent or an angular shape. In type AB3L, the molecule with three bond pairs and one lone pair acquires a pyramidal shape. A molecule of ammonia exhibits a pyramidal shape. In type AB2L2, the molecule with two bond pairs and two lone pairs acquires a bent or an angular shape. A molecule of water exhibits a bent or an angular shape. In type AB4L, the molecule with four bond pairs and one lone pair acquires a folded square or a seesaw shape. In sulfur tetrafluoride, when the lone pair is at an axial position, the geometry has low stability. On the other hand, the geometry has high stability when the lone pair is at the equatorial position. In type AB3L2, the molecule has three bond pairs and two lone pairs and acquires a T-shaped geometry. Chlorine trifluoride molecule with its lone pair at the equatorial position is the most stable. In type AB5L, the molecule has five bond pairs and one lone pair. The lone pair in the octahedral geometry can occupy any one of the positions, resulting in a square pyramidal geometry. A molecule of bromine pentafluoride shows this type of geometry. In type AB4L2, the molecule has four bond pairs and two lone pairs. The two lone pairs can occupy any two positions in the octahedral geometry, thus resulting in a square planar geometry. A molecule of xenon tetrafluoride exhibits this type of geometry. Now let's recapitulate the classification of geometries of molecules according to the VSEPR theory.
Vesper theory. The valence shell electron pair repulsion theory, commonly referred to as the Vesper theory, states that pairs of electrons surrounding the central atom of a molecule or ion will locate themselves geometrically, so they are as far from one another as possible in order to minimize repulsion between each other. The theory is based on the fact that in an atom, valence electron pairs repel one another, since like charges repel. To minimize the repulsion, the electrons distance themselves from each other, resulting in a molecular geometry. The Vesper theory can be used in predicting the shapes of molecules. Let's look at some examples so that we can see the different geometric patterns that form based on the number of valence electron pairs. In beryllium fluoride, the electrons will be found in only two places on the valence shell of the central atom, beryllium. The repulsion between the pairs will be the weakest when they are located at opposite ends of the central atom. So, according to the Vesper theory, the molecular geometry of the atoms with two pairs of valence electrons will be linear, meaning there will be an angle of 180 degrees between the fluoride bonds with beryllium. In a molecule of boron trifluoride, the valence electrons are found in three places. The three pairs of electrons can be arranged at 120 degree angles to reduce the mutual repulsion. This arrangement results in a trigonal planar molecular geometry and will hold true for other atoms with three pairs of valence electrons. In cases where the central atom has four bonding pairs of electrons, such as methane, the molecular geometry will be tetrahedral with bond angles of 109.5 degrees, between the central atom and the surrounding atoms. When a molecule has 5 pairs of valence electrons, such as in phosphorus pentafluoride, a trigonal bipyramidal structure will be formed to minimize the electron-electron repulsion. 3 positions in the trigonal bipyramid will be equatorial as they lie along the midline of the molecule at angles of 120 degrees. The 2 remaining positions will be axial as they lie perpendicular to the midline with angles of 90 degrees. In cases such as sulfur hexafluoride, where the central atom has 6 pairs of bonding electrons, the molecular geometry will be octahedral. In this geometry, 4 of the terminal atoms lie in a square plane, while 2 terminal atoms lie perpendicular to the square plane. All the angles in this geometry will be 90 degrees. Summary. Vesper theory is an acronym for valence share electron pair repulsion theory. The theory helps to predict the shapes of the molecules. The theory is based on the fact that the molecules will arrange the valence electrons to minimize the mutual repulsion.
Valence bond theory. A covalent bond is formed as a result of sharing of electrons. To explain the formation of covalent bonds and the energy changes taking place during the formation of covalent bonds in molecules, 2 theories were proposed: the valence bond theory and the molecular orbital theory. The valence bond theory, or VBT, was introduced by Walter Heitler and Fritz London. This theory was further developed by Linus Pauling. VBT is also known as the orbital concept of bonding. According to this theory, atoms retain their identity even after the formation of a molecule. Half-filled atomic orbitals present in the valence shells of atoms participating in bond formation overlap with each other. The overlapping orbitals have electrons with opposite spins. The strength of a covalent bond depends on the extent of overlap. Let's take a look at the formation of a molecule of hydrogen in light of VBT. When 1 s atomic orbitals of 2 hydrogen atoms approach each other, there exist attractive as well as repulsive forces between the electrons and nuclei of both the atoms. However, owing to the larger magnitude of attractive forces, the orbitals are drawn close to each other. This leads to the formation of a covalent bond between the atoms and a molecule of hydrogen. From the potential energy diagram for a hydrogen-hydrogen covalent bond, it is clear that as separate atoms approach each other, there is a decrease in potential energy. This energy becomes minimum when the distance between the two atoms is equal to the bond length of the molecule formed. The potential energy increases with further decrease in the distance between the bonded atoms. The valence bond theory explains the formation of covalent bonds in different molecules in terms of atomic orbital overlap. This overlap can be positive, negative, or zero. Positive overlapping occurs when orbitals overlap along the internuclear axis with the lobes bearing the same sign. Negative overlap occurs when the orbitals overlap along the internuclear axis with the lobes bearing opposite signs. When there is no interaction between the orbitals, the condition is known as zero overlap. Depending on the type of overlap, covalent bonds can be classified as sigma and pi bonds. Click each tab to learn more. This type of covalent bond is formed by the head-on or axial overlapping of bonding orbitals along the internuclear axis. Overlaps leading to the formation of a sigma bond are SS type overlap, SP type overlap, and PP type overlap. SS type overlap takes place between two half-filled S orbitals along the internuclear axis. SP type overlap takes place between half-filled S orbital of one atom and half-filled P orbital of another atom along the internuclear axis. PP type overlap takes place between two half-filled P orbitals along the internuclear axis. The sidewise overlapping of P atomic orbitals leads to the formation of pi bonds. Here, the extent of overlap is smaller than that in a sigma bond, and hence it is weaker than a sigma bond. In a molecule of ethene, a sigma bond is formed when 1,1-sp2 hybrid orbitals of both the carbon atoms overlap. Four carbon-hydrogen sigma bonds are formed between sp2 hybrid orbitals of carbon and 1s atomic orbitals of hydrogen atoms. A pi bond is formed by the sidewise overlapping of unhybridized px orbitals of carbon atoms. Hence, there is a pi charge cloud above and below the carbon-carbon bond. Let's quickly summarize the valence bond theory.
Hybridization. The process of intermixing of orbitals which have slightly different energies in order to obtain a new set of equivalent orbitals is called hybridization. The new set of orbitals which is formed is known as hybrid orbitals. Unlike the original orbitals, the hybrid orbitals have equivalent energies. The hybrid orbitals which are formed have identical shapes. Further, the number of hybrid orbitals is equal to the number of atomic orbitals which have been hybridized. The hybrid orbitals are directed in space in a preferred direction so that there is minimum repulsion between the electron pairs and the arrangement is stable. Thus, the type of hybridization indicates the geometry of the molecules. Let us now understand the common types of hybridizations which involve S and P orbitals. Click each tab to learn more. Let's learn about the formation of beryllium fluoride by SP hybridization. In this type of hybridization, 1S and 1P orbital mix to form two equivalent SP hybrid orbitals. The electronic configuration of beryllium atom is 1s2, 2s2. In the excited state, one electron from the 2s orbital gets promoted to one of the two p orbitals. Now, 1s orbital and 1p orbital of beryllium atom undergo hybridization to form linear sp hybrid orbitals with a bond angle of 180 degrees.
Each of these sp hybrid orbitals overlaps with two p orbitals of fluorine to form two sigma bonds between the beryllium and fluorine atoms in beryllium fluoride. Let's learn about the formation of boron trichloride by sp2 hybridization. In this type of hybridization, 1s and 2p orbitals mix to form three equivalent sp2 hybrid orbitals. The electronic configuration of a boron atom is 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. In the excited state of boron, one of the electrons from 2s orbital gets promoted to one of the 2p orbitals. Now, 1s and 2p orbitals of boron atom undergo hybridization to form trigonal planar sp2 hybrid orbitals with a bond angle of 120 degrees. Each of these sp2 hybrid orbitals overlaps with three p orbitals of chlorine to form three sigma bonds between the boron and chlorine atoms in boron trichloride. Let's learn about the formation of methane by sp3 hybridization. In this type of hybridization, 1s and 3p orbitals mix to form four equivalent sp3 hybrid orbitals. The electronic configuration of carbon atom is 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. In the excited state of carbon, one of the electrons from 2s orbitals gets promoted to one of the 2p orbitals. Now, 1s and 3p orbitals of carbon atom undergo hybridization to form tetrahedral sp3 hybrid orbitals with a bond angle of 109.5 degrees. Each of these sp3 hybrid orbitals overlaps with four s orbitals of hydrogen atoms to form four sigma bonds between the carbon and hydrogen atoms in methane. Let us now understand the common types of hybridizations involving s, p and d orbitals. Click each tab to learn more. Let's learn about dsp2 hybridization with the help of nickel tetracyanide 2 negative ion.